We move straight to the questions, and before asking the questions, giving the floor to the members of the panel, I'd like to thank once again for Deutsche Welle and for Mr. Dreamer for this initiative, and of course for the Nauman Foundation for Freedom for supporting this initiative again. Mr. Dreamer, who is a journalist and author of the film, I'd like to ask you maybe to deliver a few remarks on the film, how was it done, and what are your impressions, but also to ask the question whether you think Europe needs no scheme too, because from the film I don't get a clear answer. So maybe you can answer this question as well, please.
To start with the last question, this was precisely our intention, not to make clear what me and my colleague Peter and I think about the project. It's up to the viewer, it's up to you to decide whether this is good or a bad idea. We just tried to present the pros and the cons in that film, and I will reveal one secret. One of the authors was against it, and the other one was in favor of it. But I won't tell you who they would go. Just a few words about the entire film. You might have noticed that it looks sometimes a little old, but Tillerson is no longer Secretary of State. And in the meantime, we say in the commentary that there was no command of high-ranking ministers or the Chancellor Merkel on that project. Second half of March, when Ukrainian President Poroshenko was visiting Berlin, Chancellor Merkel spoke out on that project. But we stopped filming a couple of days before Christmas last year, and this film we just saw was aired the 2nd of March on Deutsche Welle TV. So, in the meantime, things have happened, and we are free to discuss it here. It's just for me as a journalist important to make clear that things have moved a little bit since this film was edited and since we wrote the text. Thank you very much for the applause. I would like to that you also welcome my colleagues from our Kiev studio, producer Nikola Bernik and operator David Schilko, who did the Northwood work. Get up, please, so that people can. That was it from my side, thanks.
Thank you for your answer. We have a distinguished panel with several people, so I'd like to introduce the entire panel. By knowledge, I was supposed to do this before giving the call, but my goal, so we have a lens of right with that team of foreign affairs of Ukraine in charge of European integration, and one of the key person in advocating maybe in advocating Ukraine's position, which concerns most people. We have Anna Kreider, Ambassador Extraordinary Potentiary of the Federal Republic of Germany, Ukraine. And we have Mara Pali, who is Member of Parliament of the Estonian Parliament and is also the Chairman of the Foreign, or the European Affairs Committee in the Parliament. Former, already. So I need to update my agenda. So, Madam Minister, my question to you is whether there is, because from the discussion we've seen, it looks like the most improved is inevitable. It looks like. I'm not saying this is certain, but it looks like. Is there a plan B for Ukraine if this is the case of the worst case scenario?
Thank you for the film producers who said the film. Essentially, I wrote from Fuso thinking, and definitely all of Europeans, they might have their own opinion, and I would like to apologize for my voice, and it's not easy task for me to advocate today for Ukraine, because I got a call. But definitely, for us, this is still a matter of our security. And we continue to insist that not only for Ukraine, but for the whole Europe, this is also a matter of security. Not only because of the lack of Russian aggression, but also because we continue to talk about the solidarity. Whereas Germany and others who are interested in this project, they insist on the commercial ground of this project. I can't agree, because we have already experience of the Nord Stream 1, which also was presented as a commercial project, which could not or would not influence the transit of Russian gas through Ukrainian territory. But we saw that indeed that amount of Russian gas which was transited through Ukrainian territory was decreased on the same amount which was started to transit through Nord Stream 1. With Nord Stream 2, whether we have the plan B. This is a kind of philosophical issue. Of course, we are thinking about the possibility of plan B, but only if Russia and Ukraine will have to operate on the same conditions, in conditions which are also implemented to the whole Europe and other European pipelines, when European legislation will be extended on Nord Stream 2 and Ukraine will become a part of European internal gas market. So in the very comprehensive and understandable conditions where Gazprom or Rosneft or Novatek will have the ability to deliver gas through any kind of pipelines to Europe on the same ground which they might have delivered through Ukraine, or European companies might may buy gas on Ukrainian eastern border, it will be an option. But whether or not Europe is ready to create such conditions which will be equal to any kind of operators on this market, this is still an issue. And we continue to discuss this issue because for us, of course, the perfect situation is the situation where we continue to supply gas from our territory up to 2020 without any streams, without Turkey stream, without Nord Stream. But this is a kind of perfect situation. And we do think about another options. However, this is a kind of our initiation position. This is just how this situation might be solved or what kind of options we might discuss with European Union.
Thank you, my answer. Ambassador, in the film, I noticed that the German government or officials on behalf of the German government were not willing to give interview or to give a comment for this film. Why do you think the German government does not want to comment on the Nord Stream 2? Is there any special reason for that?
Well, thank you very much to afternoon, everybody. First of all, I want to say thank you to Mr. Töpper and his team for having made this film. I think the film is valuable to be shown not only for a German audience, because I have a sense of a little bit from the German perspective, but also because it offers facts, even though they were, of course, in a, surrounded with big words. I have, of course, no immediate answer to your question why there was no comment. I noticed that the building is open. And it was said that there was no comment, it was the Chancellery. I don't know whether the team also asked whether other ministries in the government whether they had to comment. But anyway, to understand that the German voice you heard while speaking all the time, Gerhard Schröder, does not speak for Germany, does not speak for the German government. He speaks for himself, respectively, for the those who are employed. So please don't, for those who have watched this, please don't mix up Gerhard Schröder with the German government.
Central European gas market, and the only name make sense to build up Holman gas plant in a way that all the hardware is allocated to the Holman gas market. There can't be any separate pipes, whether it will be in Baltic Sea or somewhere else, without participating and without allocating them to the Holman electricity market. The pipe itself is not a problem. The way that it's planned to be operated, this is a problem.
At this moment, I'd like to connect our audience to this panel, the discussion, and last question or comment on the movie, on the on the film. And first, I'd like to offer the floor to two people who've been willing to comment. So, first of all, Mikhail Shurgan, who is from representing the International Renaissance Foundation in Kyiv, and who has been dealing with this issue from the side of civil society. So the floor is yours, Mike.
Thank you very much.
Is it working?
Yes, it does. Thank you very much. Actually, I haven't asked myself for the word, but the
no, but we know, you know. Know.
So you are doing it. So I will be very frank. First of all, I mean, I'm not a big expert in energy topic, so I will not go into technicalities. There are many more people who can do better than me. I maybe would like to just comment on three questions, big questions, which arise in this discussion. First, why we don't trust this project? Second, why we think that Ukraine is more trusted now? And third is, what is the possibility, the way out for out of this whole mess we have now? So the first thing is an interesting question. And we hear quite often when speaking with our German partners that Russia has been a trustful, good supplier to Germany for years and for decades. So why don't trust this one to be really trustful and good faith? The basic answer is maybe on the German side, maybe it's mostly commercial, maybe, except for the Stasi officer and the CEO. But the Russian side of the project is purely political. It's basically state-owned gas pump, controlled by the state, with a button that looks like Putin. And we know very well that actually benefit by people from these circles. So basically it means doing business with Putin. So is doing business with Putin purely a commercial project? I don't think so. And is Putin a reliable partner? Well, after some time maybe, but then he just suddenly occupies something and says that it's okay. Why we do think that it's understandable that Russia is trying to promote Ukraine as also being an unreliable partner. This is their strategy. This is basically what they try to message abroad and first of all to Germany that okay, Russia's maybe not ideal, but Ukrainians are not ideal too. We also heard some of this kind of stuff from this film as well. But again, to be at the same time, I mean, I represent civil society, which is quite critical towards the government, but at the same time, we need to appreciate what has been done, especially what has been done in the recent years. We can clearly say that it's confirmed by many evidence, by many expert assessments, international expert assessments, that gas sector in Ukraine is now more transparent than ever before. We need to say that it was specifically Russian policy to streamline corruption schemes into the Ukraine-Russian trade on gas. We've seen the political consequences of that with Crimea, and we've seen the pictures from the Viking Republic in 2000, and I remember this quite well. I also come personally from Crimea, so I mean, the whole story came to me personally, and as many other Ukrainians as well. With the Russians trying to say that Ukraine is not a reliable partner responsible for, it's very good that Mr. Schröder is not speaking for the government of Germany, but he's constantly speaking here in the film. He's again speaking that like some volumes were not delivered and so on and so on. Russia tries to bring this message in the Egyptian crisis in 2006 and 2009, and again and again. And suddenly, somehow, they never had support. The only one. Maybe one was better and will comment and correct me, but what we've searched with our experts, we've tried to search for any single case. We found only one case when Russians actually went to the court to Ukraine in the beginning of the 2000s. It went through various stages of international courts, and it resulted in the beginning of Ukrainian conflict. So the Russians were basically defeated in that case. The same as with the Stockholm arbitrage this year. And again, what was their reaction? The decrease of the volumes of transportation to Europe. Very reliable behavior. So now, I think quite a lot of speaking about who is more reliable or not. The question is, we have the reality which we have now. What is the way out? And my personal opinion is that there's no way out for Ukrainians and Russians to negotiate in good faith just between themselves and Europe to count on that, to rely on the result of these negotiations. There's no trust at all between Russia and Ukraine, and that's quite understandable. The contract is finishing in 2019, so the question is what next? The contract for the transportation for Ukraine. And my personal opinion is that we have no other option but to agree to move to the scheme when physically Russian gas flows to Ukraine, but in legal terms it is a negotiation between Russia and Europe, with the Russian gas supplied to Europe on the eastern border of Ukraine, and Ukrainian company, Naftogaz or whatever would be the company responsible for transit, negotiated on the transit, not with Gazprom, but transportation. So yeah, transportation under Gazprom, but with European consumers. So why on earth Ukrainians and Russians negotiate on the transportation of gas which flows to Europe, to other European states? It would be more logical and more stable to have it kind of as a basis for negotiations between Ukrainians and Europeans on how this transit to Ukraine is organized. So that's it. Sorry for being maybe too long and too frank, but this is really a very unique opportunity and you wanted to use it and you asked me to do it.
Thank you. We probably did a lot of questions raised, a lot of comments. Before returning to the time, I'd like to ask the question.
Thank you. Thank you very much. First of all, I'd like to thank you for the film. It's very good. It brings all the points of view. It's not unilateral. It just brings information. What is going on? This is Nord Stream 2. But my comment is more about to you, Mr. Ambassador. Your Excellency, it is very difficult to believe the German government does not understand all the consequences of the project. I do not believe that. Definitely, there are several probably analyses from all points of view. Definitely, this is a very lucrative project for Germany, and it is not possible to imagine that Germany does not understand that's a bad project for Central European members of the EU. And definitely, it is a devastating project for Ukraine. So we're not just living without $2-3 billion dollars or euros, doesn't matter, of a transit fee. That completely removes Ukraine from the energy picture of the European future energy policy. And if our transit system would become one day dry, that means without technology gas inside, it will not be possible to renew its activity, ever, ever. That's the goal of Putin. That's what he wants. It's not just about to deprive us from some revenues, which are very important for us. But if Ukraine would be left without transit system, it's huge business and hundreds of thousands of people working in this business. And that's on the eve of elections and very complicated situation that we have in Donbass and in Crimea. So that means a complete victory for him over Ukraine. And I don't understand why we are not, why we just talk, and that was mentioned by Deputy Foreign Minister Zerkal and our colleague Shulga, that there is alternative. All those companies which are involved in the Nord Stream 2 can easily negotiate with Gazprom a delivery of gas to Europe for the territory of Ukraine, buying gas on our eastern border. In this case, Gazprom will not be will have no involvement in Ukrainian gas transportation business. You will remove this corruption story. That will remove this constant allegations that again, former Chancellor Schroeder mentioned that with we are siphoning gas. This is nonsense which we have been hearing already for 7 years. So that will be European business. Do it. Buy gas, transit it through Ukraine, sell it in Europe, and you will have much more better situation in European kind of soul of unity in Europe, and Ukraine will be part of it. That's what we wanted. We are not going to impose any kind of special relations of in this business. We don't want to strike again deal with Gazprom. We want normal relations with Europe. And let me mention as well, it was not mentioned in the film, that you know, if you buy a German car, it's excellent car, we know that, but you have to buy insurance. And the same system in gas. On Nord Stream 2, there is no insurance if anything happens. In Ukraine, we have storages. We have storages purposefully built and operated to balance if anything happened on a major transit to Europe. So why not to use this as well and be sure that whatever Putin has in mind, at least you have 30 billion cubic meters capacity, which can supply a lot of consumers in Europe and balance the flow of gas in peak situations or in emergency. So that's my comment. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your comment. And I'd like to start to give the opportunity for the panel to answer. And I'll start from this side, so if you allow me, this way. So,
right things has been said. I just wanted to add to my previous comment that I, in any case, currently, as the policy has been at his support. I do not support the Nord Stream 2 and moving forward with it, because there is no clear scenario what would be the, let's say, common European energy and gas market. So, but coming back to what has been just said, this is supposed to be right, but it can't be any separate deal between stakeholders to somehow use the transmission network commercially. Transmission network must be under the control of the states. It's a good practice in Norway, and it could be the excellent working practice in Central Europe as well. And as half, let's say 40% of the gas to European Union countries flows through Ukraine. This is the scenario to continue in a way that all the parties have the equal access to the infrastructure, to the gas market, and all the prices are, let's say, figured out like a stock exchange. This is a system that works very well in multiple spots. And building up it as a Nordic gas market in Scandinavia and in Estonia as well. So I think that having, let's say, some parts of the infrastructure under commercial control is the worst thing to happen. And having some parts of the let's say, prices not allocated
There is an alternative which we had on the table in Estonia for years to just fill up the gas. We don't use gas in our energy portfolio anymore. We do this scenario and it fell up to, or let's say down to 5% or to total energy consumption, but currently, as we have as we did full amount in with the transmission network, so we bought the transmission system and network from Gazprom and allocated to that to the, let's say, state-owned DSO, and as well as we built the additional connections with Finland and Lithuania to the with Poland. We have more access to LNG, LNG terminals and so on and so on. So the gas could be a secure, let's say, source of energy. We can't build it this way, and all the gas comes from one source, and this one source has, let's say, half of the capacity under his control for the transmission as well.
That's a lot of comments in general.
Yes, indeed. I'm sorry that maybe I will have to become a little bit more extensive in what I say than I have been so far. But there was a lot also addressed to me. And of course, this whole discussion seems to be about Germany, despite the fact, which was also mentioned in the film, that this is a Gazprom plus European firms, which were enumerated in the film project, which is run by these firms. Yeah, it is not the German government project, and Germany does not identify with this project, unless we get the question. It's also not the case that that Germany is the only country which has to grant permissions for this pipeline. The permissions have to be granted by each country along which borders, whose borders the pipeline runs. And frankly, it's not only Germany, several other countries have also issued the necessary permissions. Reason being that these permissions are of technical nature and that otherwise freedom of commercial activity applies. Unless you nationalize the gas transmission network business, which is something you have moved away from some, if I don't know, say, for 30, 40 years. Now, of course, we can put that sit here out about Nord Stream 2 is not exclusively a commercial issue for the firms involved. I'm sure it's a commercial issue. For the two German firms which just be involved. For others, it is not a commercial issue. For Ukraine, it is not a commercial, not only a commercial issue. For Russia, it is not only a commercial issue. For Poland, it is not only a commercial issue, but there are also commercial elements to this. All right. So she recognizes that this is the case, that this is not only a commercial issue, and she says, I want to make sure and help arrange find an arrangement by which the Ukrainian gas transmission system remains in use. So this is the express goal formulated by my chancellor. Yeah. So what you have been saying, with all due respect, is a little bit of the past, because as far as I'm concerned, this is not what we're looking for, quite to the contrary. No. So we're trying to get to make sure that regardless of Nord Stream 2, whether it gets finished or doesn't get finished, we can have a continued gas transit for Ukraine with the income that goes with it. Maybe I'm not so convinced of that argument, but with maybe also the security benefits that Ukraine draws from continued use of the gas transit system. So, what we're now talking about is whether Germany or other countries along the road of Nord Stream 2 can take or should take action to forbid the project. Yeah. Yeah. So it's those who say Germany should forbid, please show me the law which allows Germany to forbid that. Because Germany, sorry to is a country which law. So we need a legal basis for Germany to forbid a commercial project, commercial activity by private entities. So if you can
extension of European Directive 2009/73 for offshore pipelines, we should now block in the discussion together with Netherlands, with Belgium, and with Austria.
Thank you very much for mentioning also the other countries. But of course you know as well as I do that I was speaking first with the person of German law. So German law as it exists has no clause which would allow the government to nominate. To forbid the project. Now there's the next thing, which is the proposal made by you and others, which is to extend the EU's competences so that it then becomes competent to regulate the pipeline which under the current European legal situations outside territorially outside the EU's competence. Now, I think there is resistance from quite a few countries because this is not only a Nord Stream 2 issue, but it sets the precedent for the extension of European regulations into adjacent projects which lie outside the territory. Of course, you can fine-tune the proposal so that it only applies to Nord Stream 2 and no other issue is touched. But there is in the EU, I mean, this is now part of the bigger political picture around the EU. In the EU, among the member states, there is resistance against the idea to extend further EU competence into areas where it doesn't exist so far. Because the one or other in the EU likes or doesn't like a certain issue or a certain project. Which is why, in fact, there are also countries who have no direct interest in favor of Nord Stream 2 who are not completely in favor of this. If it were otherwise, there wouldn't be a problem.
Thank you, Ambassador. Madam Minister, you seem to have the right approach in order to the connection you just mentioned, is it something in the pipeline now? something the Ukrainian government is trying to do these days? What's the strategy of trying to get to a different outcome?
It seems that, unfortunately, commercial interests prevail in solidarity. And definitely, this expansion on regulation is not about Euro Nord Stream 2. And it's interesting, but almost all countries which are now against this idea, these are countries of origin of those companies which are taking part in this project Nord Stream 2. I can't think that this issue might be solved on the political level. I mean, who can guarantee how Putin or Russia can behave, and who can guarantee any kind of amount or any amount in Ukrainian fighting after 2020, and how it's possible? We already had an experience with Budapest memorandum. And what happened? Where are these guarantees? So the same can happen with the Nord Stream. But you see the humor of this situation is that when we negotiated association agreement in 2009-2010, after the last crisis, the European Commission insisted in depositing of 10 days amount of money for the supply of gas through Ukrainian territory to Europe as a guarantee in kind of interruption of supplies. And for us it was a very uneasy situation to explain and to prove that Ukraine was not actually a reason of interruption of supplies. And that interruption of supplies is still a topic for the Mr. Schröder, despite the fact that it was not proved. You see, in our time when the false information can easily be used by any politician as a reason for action, any kind of guarantees, they simply don't work. How it can be done? By the depositing of amount of money? By the guarantees in bank? Or how? We know the experience of Turkmenistan of 2009. What Russia did with their pipeline. And what can happen with Ukrainian pipeline if the Nord Stream 2 will be operational? And no kind of insurances will be in position. Insurances, I mean that the regulation will cover offshore pipelines. Without this, any Europe pipelines which are operated by the Gazprom, they will not be secured. This is a tool for Russia, not a commodity. And this is absolutely obvious for us. And we still can't understand how to explain this for our colleagues in Europe that we are not talking about commodity. We are talking about political tool.
Mr. Trigger, would like to share?
Oh, this is a lot of number, thank you very much. I think the key question that was raised, what's the plan B? What can be done to save that Ukraine as a transit corridor? Not yet answered. Just from a journalist's perspective, when we did this interview with former Chancellor Gerhard Schröder 2 days before Christmas last year, he out of sudden said, we didn't expect that and we hadn't heard anything about it. He out of sudden said, of course we need the transport system, the gas transport system of Ukraine. We were very astounded and we edited the soundbite in the film. We were very glad that we did. Now, 3 months later, the German Chancellor said, yeah, it has a political dimension, and Ukraine needs a sort of compensation, whatever this compensation may look like. I haven't heard of any plans, of any finance budget plans or so, about how to do it. But when in late March, when this idea was outspoken that the transport system of Ukraine needs to be refurbished, needs to be kept because it's needed, I read a little news flash on a Russian website saying that Gazprom has started with preliminary planning for Nord Stream 3. So the game goes on. I don't know whether this was just, you know, intentionally really blurring the picture, something which Gazprom and other Russian companies sometimes do, or whether the expected need for consumption, for natural gas consumption in the European Union, in Western Europe, is really as high that we need the two north, that they think they need the two northern offshore pipelines plus Ukrainian land-based transport system, plus perhaps, or instead of, a third offshore pipeline. That's just an observation.
I suggest we take another round of questions and comments. So I have 1, 2, 3, and we might get the 4th one. So what we see first is, introduce yourself. I know you, but somehow you quite well.
Well, this is the right of global transformations. My question will address Mr. Zakhar and Mr. Rashid, because it actually jumped into the last phrase which you mentioned as a filmmaker, actually about plan B, let's call it like this, and some concreteness. Because we can speak, and here I maybe disagree with Deputy Minister, we can speak about values, but nowadays times and for the next years to come, not only for Ukraine, it's not about so much values, but about the result. Our final result of our final aim for Ukrainians, this is lesson number one since 2014, is just very simple, to survive. Regardless of any other things, just to survive. It's my point of view. But then the question. I find it's a very positive sign for Mrs. Merkel to talk about some, let's call it, compensation or just some kind of juncture to guarantee for Ukraine for this transit. Let's be concrete. For you, Mr. Russia. Because of visit of Mr. Altmaier to Kyiv and talks in Kyiv, Moscow backwards in Kyiv, how many PCM sees Germany should be transmitted through Ukrainian system to be more or less viable and to some extent even profitable? And to Mr. Kharkov, maybe the same question, maybe you can answer the same. How Ukrainian side have, and I do know that we have estimations about how many PCMs do we need really, and whether do you see it's possible, for example, to propose for German side this kind of plan B, guarantee, for example, let us be 80, 90 PCM per year for next 10 years to come, and firm guarantee that that will be the case. Or we reject this option B from the start.
Thank you, Alexei. Would you like to answer?
You see, I still believe in market relations. And I still believe that our work on the approximation of legislation has a name of more full integration into EU market. This is not just a word for the sake of work. We do this with the purpose to become a part of European gas market and to have the same regulation and the same treatment as other EU member states and to have the possibility to open our market to the European companies and to serve definitely as a kind of service for transportation of gas from Russia to Europe and to open the possibility of European companies to enter on this market to good capacities and to have direct access to Russia. And we will just ensure this transportation. For us, this is not just a plan. This is the work we have been done for years. This is actually envisaged investigation agreement. And now we are talking about the further development of the association agreement with a view to split all kinds of regulations of the internal market in gas to Ukraine. But we also need to have the same conditions for other pipelines, which are offshore pipelines. In this regard, we will have more competitive market where all kinds of companies can operate. This is our plan B.
Thank you. Mr. Would you like to react or collect more questions?
Thank you, if I can. There are conflicting expert opinions on how much the gas will be consumed, needed in Europe in the next 10, 20 years. And that is what actually answers the question of whether or not, which is only taken as a fact, whether or not there's the potential for Nord Stream 2 to make obsolete the Ukrainian gas transit system. Now, the idea of putting the point of purchase from the EU outer border to the Ukrainian-Russian border only works under the assumption that Nord Stream 2 does not make the Ukrainian gas transit system obsolete, or that, of course, Nord Stream 2 is not built. If everything goes to Nord Stream 2, then it doesn't matter whether the port of purchase is there, no transportation will be made in that sense. So that's not a plan B. That is an add-on to plan A. Namely, either we all agree here that Nord Stream 2 does not make Ukraine gas transportation to Ukraine unnecessary. That's one thing. I wouldn't be sure, but I can't exclude this possibility. Or we assume that Nord Stream 2 will make Ukrainian capacity, transportation capacity. So then it doesn't matter where the foreign purchase is. But, okay, so.
But again, the most one is to expand the regulation on the offshore pipeline.
Yes, I know that. I know that you're saying that. But my point is what you have been arguing is not a plan B, because it builds on the assumption that Nord Stream 2
Not exactly. Let's talk about the extension of EU regulation on Nord Stream 2. And you will see that Nord Stream 2 commercial won't be so perfect anymore. And in this situation, Nord Stream 2 will have to operate as any other European pipelines without Gazprom domination on this pipeline. So in this respect, there will be another policy on tariffs on Nord Stream 2, another policy on competition, and other regulations. Whether it will be commercially beneficial, this is the question in this respect.
Well, okay, I don't have the background information to tell you which route under which conditions would be more or less beneficial commercially. I bow to your better information then. But to answer your question, I won't answer your question. Because, of course, what Minister Altmaier discussed when he was here is confidential, and B, how many billion cubic meters of gas would flow through the Ukrainian gas pipeline system under the water condition is a matter to be negotiated. We can't just decide that this will be the case. As much as we can't simply decide among us here that we put the point of purchase to the Ukrainian-Russian border, there are more parties to this who need to agree. In fact, the parties which need to agree on the EU side is not the EU or Germany even, but it is the firms which have contracts with Gazprom for the are buying their gas. And they have long-term gas contracts, if I'm not mistaken, of 25 years or more, which they
separate things that are slippery rope, because as you know, usually governments come
separate
into common.
Between who and who are you talking about? This is so generic. Who are you talking about?
Let me finish my
remarks. Oh, well, this is relevant to what I say.
It might be, but I'll finish my thought. It is slippery because usually after each 4 years, governments come and go, and these exclusive agreements can be at the same time withdrawn. Okay, it could be continued if the environment is okay to continue with that, but it could be withdrawn as well. But it's much harder to smash and withdraw the common agreements of a well-functioning marketplace. So that's the idea, to build up a well-functioning marketplace so that it would be hard to that one government or the other government or one company or the other company will play a role in withdrawing the agreements.
Thank you. I saw several hands, so one hand there. Please introduce us all. Yes,
sir. My name is Sidney Sherwood of Fulton's International Agency. Dear colleagues, Ms. Ambassador, Madam Minister, dear colleagues from Friedrich Naumann, and dear colleagues from New York Center, thank you very much for this event. Incredibly important event. About myself, for more than 20 years, I have worked for National Institute of Strategic Studies, providing expertise for all presidents' team. I'm not politically engaged with any political force, and I provided expertise on geopolitics of pipeline and Ukrainian energy security as well, to all president teams. So, Madam Minister, let me disagree with you. I think that Ukraine is approaching to the issue. Until today, we were able to sit on two chairs, American and European. Currently, we are in a very sensitive issue where actually Ukraine have to take a decision whether we will sit with Europe as we approach into Europe. So what is the North Stream 2? It is an independence. It is an energy independence of Germany and Europe. And we Ukrainians should be strongly interested here. Secondly, what is a North Stream 2 is actually security for Ukrainian pipelines, because Ukrainian pipelines would never use as a chantage tool of Europe. Third thing, what is Nord Stream 2 if it will be built? It is actually investment in the Ukrainian peace process, because it's Nord Stream 2, continuation ongoing and without the end. Continuation of Ukraine conflict in Ukraine becomes an absolutely useless investment, geopolitical investment. Also, because of Nord Stream 2, it would inevitably make gas price for Europe cheaper. So Ukrainian gas consumers should be interested to build Nord Stream 2, because it is for benefit of our people. Finally, I would like to congratulate Germany for great decision and Europe. Because if you succeed with Nord Stream 2, it means that Germany returns to great global geopolitics. And because of this, it would be beneficial for Ukraine. Thank you very much.
You.
So my question was to all panelists. Who are the strong opposition in Europe currently to this Nord Stream 2, and what can be done? Thank you.
Thank you for your question. Gentlemen, there, introduce yourself.
My name is Igor Bronsky. For more than 20 years, I was active on energy and environmental issues and civil society organization. Actually, as an environmentalist, I'm against any new pipelines. As a citizen of Ukraine, I'm against any of Russian new pipelines. So everybody who is against Nord Stream 2 is my double friend. I know that our Minister of Foreign Affairs takes great efforts to find new allies to convince every government in Europe to resist to this project, but we don't know. There is a story which can seriously undermine such efforts, and it's not further on the guests, it's on the bigger, but as promised, the ground. And it's also about doing business with Putin. There is a so-called Czech company, Škoda GS, and this company doesn't provide produce cars. It just names the same way. It should produce nuclear power plants. Indeed, it doesn't produce it itself because this company is part of the bigger Russian company, which is called Объединенная машиностроительная завода, Unified Machinery Plants. And then, surprise, surprise, this company is co-owned by Gazprombank, headed by Mr. Miller. And now, every day, the Cabinet of Ministers of Ukraine can approve the so-called terms of reference, technical-экономичное основание, for the project for construction of, actually completing of two nuclear reactors at Khmelnytsky power plant, which were stopped back in the 80s. And Škoda GS is decided as a subcontractor in this project. So basically, our government is one step from improving the new deal, multi-billion deal, actually with Russia. And I had no chance to check with ministry. Come on.
We have a focus. I mean, that's what I say. This discussion is dedicated.
But if you are talking about plan B and efforts, such move can undermine such efforts. But this is as you know. So no, we cannot live in the sphere and forget about other things behind the frames. So actually, I hope very much that there will be now season two for this movie, where we'll see the Škoda GS, Gazprombank, again ZUG, because they have also registration in ZUG, maybe next door to the Gazprom. And I believe that there will be no such decision by the government about this project issue.
Thank you for your question. There's one question, gentlemen. Introduce yourself.
Yeah, my name is Milani Bartik. I represent the Center for Freedom of Speech, and I was an MD by another conference here at Downstairs. And I just came by chance because I live in Germany for, I've been living in Germany for 25 years. And I know exactly what is going on there. And I don't know exactly much, but his name is Ernst, which implies truthful and serious person. And they don't jump. They're very reasonable people. They're very reasonable. And you are just fighting against the wall or against a little thing. Ukraine is a big, be reasonable. I mean, you telling me that you are for economic or market relations, but you're trying to be for the owner of the gas to sell it. Is it reasonable at all? I mean, you propose some different versions of this deal, but I mean, the reasonable people like Germans, they know exactly what they need, and they know exactly what they say in Germany.
Are you implying that Ukrainians are not reasonable? Or
no, no,
but I'm trying to talk to you. To make say your comments from the expert base,
It's a comment, but what I'm trying to make my point is that you have to be reasonable, you're trying to find a reasonable solution, not like for a pizza. Build something positive. It's enough to rename some stuff, destroy some stuff. Build something positive. I've been working before by Antonov, you know, Antonov is like the refractor, the best. You destroyed this all this. I mean, it's a new machine. I mean, trying to be positive here, and whatever, it's impossible, but what I hear. I mean, just be reasonable.
Thank you. I destroyed Antonov, and we will take another round of I will take another round of questions. Please, who would like to start? If there's anyone who would like to start.
Thank you very much. I think we here on the podium, if you want to speak to the subject matter we are discussing. I have to point out, please don't misunderstand. I am not the defender of Nord Stream 2 here. This also goes to those in the audience who think that I represent this position. Certainly, it is always right to be pragmatic and reasonable and to face one's political efforts on facts. Facts and their legal situations, we are discussing those. So it is, I think, insufficient to have a very general discussion as it is prevalent here in Ukraine, unfortunately. So this is legal. One has to look more into the subject matter, to the various sides of this. But I admit at the same time that certainly we can have different opinions on this. And which opinion you have certainly always depends on which country you live in. You see all the applause that I'm suddenly unexpectedly getting from the audience has prompted me to kind of step back for a moment.
The reason why we think that Nord Stream 2 is a bad idea is that it's not about the pipeline as such, it's about the country of origin of this pipeline. It's about the evil behind. And definitely, you can't hide and you can't close your eyes on the possible consequences of the actions of this evil. And you can't predict these actions. We are not talking about the normal partner who are operating on the normal market conditions. We are talking about Russia. Whether or not we want it, but this is a kind of aggressor which can easily interrupt supplies in a harsh winter time, which can occupy a part of territory, which can easily blow up pipeline or do what he wants to do. Actually, we can't predict any other steps. That's why we want to secure the situation somehow. And now we are talking about the purely legal way how to secure the situation, how to make it most suitable for any country on the European region. And it's not about the German position, it's not about the American position, it's about our common European peace and security.
Could be currently 93, I guess it could be half, let's say
there is no point to that kind of discussion because 5 years in terms of energy security and in terms of the security of supply is a short time. And I mean, building up energy infrastructure, it must have a more strategic approach by states as well. Because just a person, Mr. Ambassador, but I've learned quite a lot about energy security and been working in that sphere for more than 10 years. But for example, in Germany, we lack connections since the early 90s, and then we've invested quite a lot of tariff money to connect ourselves with Norway, with to South, also with gas pipeline with Finland, and it's all paid by our taxpayers and through tariff. But we have, or as you have, a challenge in Germany connecting North and South in terms of electricity connections. And that could happen, these kinds of things could happen if we only follow the commercial interest and the aside the strategic and energy security. I'm not saying that you have a problem with energy security, but we felt in our country that in some, let's say, regions, in some capacities, we are lacking the enough capacity in terms of electricity lines and in terms of gas pipelines to develop more, to invest more, for example, in gas. In terms of gas, we had a challenge to invest more to gas in transportation because we didn't have enough access to consume the gas. So there is a need to have a strategic view by the government as well. And I, as much as I've understood, European Commission currently has approached and proposed a strategic view for the common European energy market.
I feel that it's time to move to the next stage, which is the informal discussion, if you allow me. Because I think we have had a little bit tense discussion. The issue is very divisive. I have to say that myself as a moderator, it was difficult for me to moderate a little bit. But I feel also for the speakers, it was not easy to confront the comments and questions we had. So please join me in saying thank you to this distinguished panel.